The world today is facing many, many problems. It's in trouble. Men and women are seeking solutions to the insurmountable problems they are facing, personal, social, national, and even international. We are asking the question, why is there so much hatred in this world between different races, between different ethnic groups? Is there no solution to this world's problem? Is it going to get worse and worse? And the answer is, the only solution is found in God, in the wonderful, incredible good news of the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. You see, the gospel of Jesus Christ is the best news any human being can ever hear. It is God's solution to our sin problem. And the only solution that man can have to solve this terrible problem that is coming to our earth. But you know, Satan, the prince of this world and the enemy of soul, hates this gospel. And so very early in the history of the Christian church, he has tried to pervert it. And to some degree, he has had success. In fact, the Apostle Paul, the great champion of the everlasting gospel, made this statement to the church in Thessalonica, chapter 2 of 2 Thessalonians and the first four verses. He says, before Christ can come the second time to bring an end to the sin problem, there will be a falling away from this wonderful, incredible good news of the gospel. And this took place during the Dark Ages. But you know, the wonderful thing is that Jesus promised, he prophesied in Matthew 24, verse 14, that before the end of this world comes, this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all its fullness, in all its power, as a witness to the entire human race. The reason for this is because God wants none to perish. And so, in this series of studies that we are going to present, which I have entitled The Unfolding of the Gospel, we are going to look at Scripture and see what this incredible good news of the gospel is all about. Now, the Bible makes it very clear. Jesus did not come to save good people. He came to save sinners. In fact, Paul tells us in his letter to Timothy, 2 Timothy, or rather 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 15, that Jesus Christ came into this world to save sinners. And then he adds in the present tense, of whom I am chief. And so what we're going to do at this first study is to look at the sin problem so that the gospel becomes meaningful. You know, the stars shine the best when the sky is the darkest. And it's only against the context, it's only against the background of our sin problem that the gospel becomes meaningful. Now, Satan has deceived the world. He has convinced the entire human race of a lie. And that lie is this, that God takes only good people to heaven and he punishes the bad people in hell. You see, if that is true, then it opens the door for what we call in English legalism, salvation by human effort. In fact, every false religion, every non-Christian religion is based on this foundation that man has to be good before he can be saved. But that is not what the Bible teaches. The Bible teaches that all have sinned. All have come short of the glory of God. The Bible teaches that there is none righteous, not even one. Let me read you a text that brings this out. In Romans, which Luther described as the clearest gospel of all, Paul spends from chapter 1, verse 18, right up to chapter 3, verse 20, dealing with the sin problem. I would like to look at the conclusion he comes to. Here it is. I'm going to use my New King James Version. And if you want to follow your Bibles, you may use your own translation. They all say the same thing, just use different words. Here it is. Chapter 3 of Romans, verses 9 to 20, is the conclusion of the sin problem, the universal sin problem. Listen to what he says. What then? Are we better than they? Who is the we and who is the they? Well, Paul, in his discussion of the sin problem, divides the human race into two camps, believers and unbelievers. By believers, I mean Jews, and by unbelievers, I mean Gentiles. That's how the Jews looked at the human race. They were God's people, the Gentiles were sinners. But Paul is saying that it doesn't matter whether you're a Jew, that is we, or you're a Gentile, that is they. Why? Because all Jews and Gentiles are under sin. That's in verse 9. And the word under was a term used during the slave society of Paul's day. A slave was under his master. He had no choice. He had no freedom. And Paul is saying, sin is our master from birth. That is why he goes on to say in verse 10, there is none righteous, no, not one. In verse 12, they have all gone out of the way. They have together become unprofitable. There is none who does good, no, not one. And then in verse 19, he sums up the whole problem. Now we know that whatever the law says, it says to those who are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped and all the world may become guilty before God. Now let me explain what he means by this statement. Paul tells us in the previous verses that the Jews had an explicit knowledge of the law. That is, they knew the law because God had given them in writing on tables of stone at Mount Sinai. The Gentiles had the law only in their conscience. They knew what was right and what was wrong. But Paul says, ultimately, it doesn't matter whether you have an explicit knowledge of the law or an implicit knowledge of the law, because both Jews and Gentiles have not kept it. So he concludes in verse 19, we know that what the law says, it says to those that are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped and all the world, that is the entire human race, may become guilty before God. In other words, the work of the law is not to save us. God never gave the law to save sinful men. God knows. In fact, in verse 20, he says, by the deeds of the law, no flesh will be justified in God's eyes. All that the law can do is give us the knowledge of sin. But see, sin is a deceiver. And therefore, God had to give the law to open the lid of our self-respectability and show us how rotten we are inside. That is why in this first study, I would like to look at the biblical definition of sin. You see, from man's point of view, sin is only an act. Sin is something that I have done wrong. But the Bible goes beyond that. So we are going to look at the biblical definition of sin. Now I'm going to be honest with you. What I'm going to present paints a very dark, dismal, hopeless picture of mankind. But that is necessary for the gospel to become meaningful. Have you ever tried to offer a plate of food to a man or a woman who has just come out of a banquet? They have no desire to eat anymore, because their stomachs are full. Whereas if you offer a plate of food to somebody who hasn't eaten for 3 days, he'll bow down and kiss your feet for this plate of food. That is why God first has to show us how sinful we are, that from head to foot, there's nothing good in us. In fact, Paul will bring that out about himself in Romans 7 and verse 18. He says, in me there is nothing good. Oh yes, I have a desire to do good. I even choose to do good, but how to do it, I find not. So what we're going to do now is to look at the sin problem as Scripture defines it. Now the Old Testament was written in the Hebrew language, and it uses some 12 different words to define sin. That's how wide and deep and long is the sin problem. The New Testament was written in the Greek language, and the Greek language in the New Testament uses 5 different words for sin. But if we put all these words together, we come across 7 categories of sin. And when we analyze and look at these 7 categories of sin, we cry out in despair, who can be saved? And the answer from the lips of Jesus Christ is, with man it is impossible, with God all things are possible. But before we can go to the incredible good news of the gospel, let's look at these seven categories of sin. The first one defines sin, at least in the King James, as the transgression of the law. That's found in 1 John chapter 3 and verse 4. But the actual text in the original language says, sin is lawlessness. And that means deliberately choosing a life of sin. Now it is true, not everyone belongs to this category. But those who have deliberately chosen to live a life of sin, these are the bad people that we read about in the newspapers, who do terrible things for no reason. The Bible will define them as 1 John 3, 4 does. Sin is lawlessness. The second definition of sin is a mental consent to a temptation or a sinful desire, the sin of coveting. Let's read about it. Chapter 7 of Romans brings it out. You see, Paul, before he became a Christian, before his conversion, was a Pharisee. Now, the word Pharisee means somebody who has separated himself from society and spent 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, trying to be good, trying to keep all the rules of his church. This is my definition of sin, of a Pharisee. One who takes meticulous care in keeping all the rules of his church, takes great pains doing it, and gives great pains to everybody else while doing it. And we have some of those today in the Christian church. Paul was one of those. In fact, in Philippians 3 verse 6, he says, regarding the righteousness of the law, I was blameless. If he was living today, we would have called him a holy Joe. But now listen to what he says in Romans 7 verse 7 and 8, after God opened his eyes. In the previous verses of chapter 7, Paul has explained why and how God had to deliver us from under law. And the reason, of course, is because God's law is holy, it's good, it's righteous, and we are sinners. In other words, God's holy law and sinful man are incompatible. Therefore, God has to deliver us from under law, place us under grace, so that salvation could be a hope for us sinners. Having said this, he raises the question in chapter 7, verse 7. What shall we say then? Is the law sin? He's just told us in Romans 6, verse 18 to 22, that Christ delivered us from sin. Then in chapter 7, the first 6 verses, he tells us Christ has delivered for us from under law. And he does not want to give the impression that sin and the law are synonymous. So he's raising this question. Is the law sin? And his answer is certainly not. Or God forbid, this is unthinkable. On the contrary, he adds, I would not have known sin except through the law, for I would not have known covetousness unless the law had said, you shall not covet. Now please notice the law he chooses from the Ten Commandments that God gave the Jews. Thou shalt not covet is not a physical act. It's a sinful desire cherished in the mind. And so he goes on in verse 8 onwards, but sin taking opportunity by the commandment produced in me all manner of evil desire. Please notice, not evil acts, but evil desire. For apart from the law, sin was dead. In other words, if I had not understood the law, I would not have understood sin. And I explained to you earlier why. Because to human beings, sin is an act. Sin is doing something wrong physically. But in God's eyes, sin is a sinful desire that you have cherished, even though you may not commit the act. For example, if I'm sitting in a classroom taking an exam, and it's an exam that I have difficulty with because it's mathematics. And so before I come to the exams, I write all kinds of formulas between my fingers. And now at the exam, I have a question and I know the answer is between my fingers. So I want to now copy. I want to cheat. But the trouble is the teacher is standing by me. And so I do not want him to see me copying. And I say to myself, I wish he would leave, but he doesn't. And the bell rings and the exam is over. I have not copied, I have not cheated, because the examiner was there by my side. But in God's eyes, I have sinned. I may not have sinned in the eyes of the examiner, but in God's eyes, because I chose, I planned to sin, I coveted to sin, but I did not do it because of circumstances. So sin is a mental consent to the law. In Matthew 5, 27 and 28, you find the same thing. In James 1, verse 14, you find the same thing. So sin is not only deliberately choosing a life of wrongdoing, sin is also a mental consent. Now number three, sin is unbelief, a deliberate rejection of a biblical truth. In the days of Paul, there was a big issue among the Christians. And the issue was, we don't face it today, but the issue in those days was, is it right or is it wrong for Christians to eat food offered to idols? You see, the idols, the pagans in the Paul's day would offer food to the idols. And of course, the priest would take this food, sell it to the market, because that is how they earn their keep. And the question was, is it right for a Christian to go to the market and buy this food offered to idols? Well, listen to how Paul responds to this issue. Chapter 14 of Romans, and I'm reading verse 23. But he who doubts is condemned if he eats. In other words, if he thinks in his mind that it is wrong to eat this food or to buy and eat this food, then he's sinning, because he does not eat from faith. And then he makes this statement, for whatever is not from faith, or whatever is of unbelief, because that's what unbelief is not of faith, is sin. So sin is deliberately rejecting a truth from the Word of God that the Holy Spirit has convicted you of. Number four, sin is defined in the Bible also as a neglect of known duties or opportunities. Boy, that's how deep the Bible defines sin. I know there are certain things that I should do, and I don't do it. The Bible calls that sin. Where is that found? In James, chapter 4 of James and verse 17. Listen to this. And when you realize this, you will say, how can I sin? How can I live without sin? Chapter 4 of James, and I read verse 17. Therefore, to him who knows to do good and does not do it, it is sin. To him, it is sin. Have you got it? Neglect of known duties or opportunities is sin. And tell me, who is innocent of this sin? All of us have failed at one point or another of doing the thing that we should be doing, and we haven't done it. Now I go to number five, and this gets even worse. Doing a wrong thing out of ignorance. Ignorance. You do not know you're doing wrong, but in God's eyes, it is sin. Okay, here it is. It's in the book of the law called Leviticus. You see, the book of the law is the first five books of the Old Testament. The Jews call it the Torah. In Leviticus chapter 5, listen to this, and I'm reading verse 17 to 19. If a person sins and commits any of these things which are forbidden to be done by the commandments of the Lord, though he does not know it, yet he is guilty and shall bear his iniquity. Brother, what hope is there for man in his own strength? Well, let's go to number six. And number six and number seven gets even worse. You see, the first five definition of sin has to do with behavior, whether of the body or of the mind. But now, number six and seven goes even further. Our sinful natures, which we inherited from Adam, is sin. Let me give you a text, one that opened the eyes of Martin Luther. Chapter 51 of Psalms, the book of Psalms, chapter 51, look at verse 5. Behold, David said, or penned, I was brought forth in iniquity. And that's one of the 12 words for in the Hebrew language for sin. Now, iniquity in Hebrew means bent or bent towards self. And he says, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin my mother conceived me. Have you got it? He's not saying that his mother committed the sin. He's simply saying what Luther defined very clearly, that this matter that I'm made of itself is sin. And that is why the only thing that you and I can do is sins. You see, our sins don't make us sinners. Our sins only prove that we are sinners. But we are sinners by nature. Paul tells us in Romans 5 verse 19, by one man's disobedience, that is by Adam's disobedience, the many, meaning the human race, were made, past tense, sinners. In chapter 58 of Psalms, listen to this. Chapter 58 in verse 3. Listen to what David also wrote. The wicked are estranged from the womb and go astray as soon as they are born, speaking lies. Brother, isn't that terrible? And then the last one is number 7. According to Scripture, sin is also a principle, a force. Paul calls it the law of sin in my members in Romans 7. Now, the word law here has a similar meaning as the law of gravity. The law of gravity is a constant force that pulls everything in our atmosphere toward the center of the earth. Likewise, in your members, in your body, every part of it, there is a force pulling you down towards sin. Yes, you can defy that force for a season, just like an aeroplane defies the law of gravity. But an aeroplane cannot stay up in the air forever. When the fuel runs out, the law of gravity will take over. Let me illustrate what I mean. But first of all, let me read the text so that you are familiar with it. Romans chapter 7. I'll begin with verse 20 up to 24. For the good that I will to do, I do not do. But the evil I will not do, that I practice. What he's saying, I want to do good, but I find I cannot do it. Now, if I do what I will not to do, it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells in me. Please notice, it is sin that dwells where? In me. And then he adds in verse 21 onwards, I find then a law, a principle, a force, that evil is present with me, the one who wills to do good. In other words, verse 22, I delight in the law of God according to the inward man. Now that phrase, inward man, is a Pauline expression that applies only to Christians. It's the converted mind. Paul will use the same phrase in 2 Corinthians 4:16, the same phrase in Ephesians 3 verse 16. So he says, in my converted mind, I delight in the law of God. I want to do God's will. But there's a but in verse 23. But I see another law, another force, another principle in my members warring against the law of my mind, that is my converted mind, and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. And then he cries out, oh, wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? And listen to his triumphalistic answer. I thank God through Jesus Christ, our Lord. So, sin is something that we have to come to grips with. And the Bible paints this dark, dismal, hopeless picture of mankind. Not because he wants to discourage you, but because he wants you to accept his gift of salvation in Jesus Christ. You see, when you realize these 7 categories of sin, you will realize that there is nothing good in us. Even our righteousness, says the prophet Isaiah, chapter 64 and verse 6. Even our righteousness in God's eyes is filthy rags. And so in closing, I'm going to read you 2 passages to show you that the prerequisite to accept the gospel, this incredible good news of salvation, which is able to deliver us from sin, is to recognize that you are a sinner. The first one is in Ephesians chapter 2, and the first three verses as a prerequisite for verse 4 and 5. And that's the second part of the passage I want to read. And you, Paul says in verse 1 of chapter 2 of Ephesians, who were dead in trespasses and sins, in which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience, among whom also we all once conducted ourselves in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath. But there's a but. But God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us. And that's what we're going to study in the next study. God's incredible love, his astonishing love, which is the ground of our salvation. And it is my prayer that you shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. May God bless you. Amen.